History of Science, which is less frequent as a choice, but there are some previous ones, and we're very happy to have our guest today, who will be introduced by my colleague Roberto Contino shortly. This is just to remind you that the next event will take place on March the 7th, and it will be devoted to gravity waves. The next one will take place in April 18, and it will be devoted to biology. Thank you very much.
So it's a real pleasure for me to introduce Professor Luigi Russo. So Lucio Russo. So Lucio Russo is a physicist, a mathematician, a philologist, and historian of science. He's a professor of probability at the University of Rome Tor Vergata since 84 in the math department. And he was a visiting professor at Princeton University and at the Institut des Etudes Scientifiques in France. So he's active, he spent efforts on studying the theory of probability and complex systems. And I like to mention among his most important contributions in the field, those on the theory of percolation, on the Ising model, and on threshold phenomena and the 0-1 law. However, Professor Russo is also well known, not just because of his contributions to these subjects, but also on his works on history of science. And here he made several original works on, among others, among the studies on the astronomer Hipparchus and his time, studies on the proof of heliocentrism attributed to Plutarch to Seleucus of Seleucia, the studies of the theories of tides. This is another subject that Professor Russo studied in quite detail, from Hellenistic to modern age. And also studies on book one of Euclid's Elements. So apart from these, because of his contributions on history science that I just mentioned, he is an author of many books on the subject, more than 10. I've counted actually probably 11, but I'm not sure whether there are more, including probably the most known book, The Forgotten Revolution, written in 96, which in Italian, La Rivoluzione Dimenticata, which was translated in four languages, including English, which is probably his most influential book and contains, I think, many of his results and theses which he obtained during his research. So on this book, I will be very quick and then pass the stage to Professor Russo. He made a very thorough study of science and technology, of what was science and technology, and which means society, during the Hellenistic time, roughly between the 4th and the 2nd centuries, and put forward the very fascinating, I would say, hypothesis, actually thesis, that during this period, science reached a level of maturity and complexity which went unmatched until Renaissance in Europe and were reached in many different fields, so mathematics, mechanics, optics, geography, astronomy, and so on. So his book is really contains an amazing amount of data in the sense of information. And I think that one of the most striking things which impresses a reader is the fact that his methodology is is special in the fact that he has the twofold competence, both in science and in philology. So he is able to read directly the sources and in their original language, Greek and Latin, and also interpret the scientific results which are found in these sources. And this is not something common, I would say, in this field. So he has this twofold attitude, which makes him very successful in this in his research. So the conclusions in his book, which I think are a prelude for what he will tell us today, the conclusion is that based on this evidence that he analyzed, he concludes that modern science, so that the science at the time of the Hellenistic period, reached a level which we can define modern. So, the if you want the in a way in which we can define today as a body of knowledge, which has an internal logical consistency, can be tested and falsified possibly by experimental techniques. Okay, so this is a way to define modern science, and this definition applies according to his thesis to the science of Hellenistic time, and eventually this scientific progress, which was reached at the time, was later somehow forgotten by the fact that the Roman conquest, which was very abrupt on historical times, put an end to any kind of scientific important scientific studies and exchange of ideas. So that was really a moment of an end of that period, which in which science flourished. So the conclusions that Professor Russo, but also the reader can draw is that well, first of all, we should maybe in light of these conclusions, we should maybe reconsider our vision of the ancient times. I mean, the ancient certainly science and technology, which means society. And the other lesson which I would draw is that scientific progress is not by no means a steady and inevitable progress. Okay, so it's something which could actually go back, okay, and then of course rises the questions on the future of modern science. So today, Professor Russo will tell us about, in particular, geographical knowledge during the Hellenistic times, and as we will see, this has fascinating implications concerning the contacts among civilizations. Please.
Well, I thank Professor Contino for this presentation. Maybe I am more able to read Greek than to speak English, so I hope that my English is understandable. So the talk is about some results on the history of ancient mathematical geography. The main result is the knowledge in Hellenistic times of some location in Central America. There is a long road to this conclusion, so I start with a very simple result, well, very well-known results. Eratosthenes in the third century BC measured the circumference of the Earth. The picture is referred to a summer solstice at noon. A is the city of Alexandria, and P is just the intersection of the meridian through A with the Tropic of Cancer. So solar rays are vertical in P at noon, and they form an angle alpha with the vertical in A. And alpha is obviously also the angle between the vertical in A and the vertical in P. So if I know alpha and also D, so the distance along the meridian between A and the tropic, then it's very easy to compute the length of all the circumference, because obviously alpha, the ratio between alpha and the turn is the same as the ratio between D and the old circumference. So alpha can be measured very easily in Alexandria. The much more difficult is the measure of D, and there are different opinions on the method used by Eratosthenes on this point. The result, however, was the value of 252,000 stadia, corresponding to 700 stadia per degree. In order to evaluate the error of this measure, we should know how long was the stadium, of course. And this is the a problem. The opinion, different opinion on this point were proposed. And the majority of the most authoritative scholars assumed for the stadium the length of 157.5 meters. And if this value is accepted, the error is less than 1%, about 7.5 per thousand. And several scholars, on the other hand, assumed that the stadium was the Attic Stadium. The Attic Stadium was at the length of 185 meters. And in this case, the error is more than 16%. So the situation is completely different. So the Attic Stadium of 185 meters was widely used. This is certain. But the other value, 157.5, is deduced by a passage in Pliny. And Pliny writes that this was the length of the stadium according to the Eratosthenes ratio. So he's saying that Eratosthenes was introducing a new stadium just of this measure. So it's a very important passage. Now I have to say something about the measure of longitudes. It was very difficult to measure difference of longitudes at that time. And so Eratosthenes, in his geographical work, writes only latitudes in degrees. Instead of longitude, he used the distances in stadia between different meridian along a given parallel. Most of the cases he used the parallel through Athens. In the second century AD, so 100 years later, Hipparchus introduced an astronomical method for measuring longitudes and deducing them from difference between the local times of lunar eclipses, the starting of the observation of lunar eclipses, of course. Now, after Hipparchus, as a consequence of the Roman conquest of the Mediterranean world, scientific research was interrupted, and in particular mathematical geography was abandoned. Later geographers came back to qualitative descriptions without any use of coordinates. The use of latitude and longitude was completely forgotten. And in the second century AD, so four centuries after Eratosthenes, Ptolemy tried to recover Hellenistic science in astronomy. It's well known, his work in astronomy, but also in geography, in optics, and in other fields. Oh, this is, I hope that this gives an idea of the breakdown between Hipparchus and Ptolemy. This is just the time distribution of the astronomical, all the astronomical observation quoted in the Almagest. Each bar corresponds to 20 years, and the timeline is from the 8th century BC until the time of Ptolemy, so the second century AD. We see two peaks, one very large corresponding to the observation made by Ptolemy himself, and the other peak is is given by observation made by Hipparchus. Now there are many observations before Hipparchus. The first is in the 8th century BC. This is our observation made in Mesopotamia. There was no astronomy in Greece at that time. But Ptolemy does not know any observation in the last two centuries and one half before him. I think this gives an idea that he is trying to recover knowledge which was forgotten for more than two centuries. And this gives an idea that it's possible that some misunderstanding by him. Now, in the geography, in Ptolemy's geography, written about 150 AD, are reported the latitudes and the longitudes of 6,345 locations. There are two main features, two errors, as we shall see in this treatise. One is that the difference of longitudes are dilated in a systematical way. And the other is that Ptolemy does not accept the measure of the earth made by Eratosthenes, and instead of the measure of 252,000 stadia, he assumed a total for the circumference of the earth of 180,000 stadia, corresponding to 500 stadia per degree instead of 700. Now, there is some discussion about if this is really an error or if he is using a different value of the stadium. But the error of the difference of longitudes is certain. Longitudes can be measured in degree exactly in the same way at the time of Ptolemy and now. So I tried to work on this problem of the duration, the difference of longitude many years ago, but I had two problems and gave up. One problem is that the majority of the location considered by Ptolemy cannot be identified, or at least cannot be identified in a certain way. And on the other hand, for many regions of the world, there are other kinds of error which overlaps with the systematic dilation of longitudes. Just because Ptolemy had an insufficient knowledge of the geography. For example, this is true for India, but also for Northern Europe, for example. So I have studied just a sample of localities, a sample of a location. The sample was chosen in this way. I have considered only regions well known in Hellenistic times. And for these regions, I consider only the most important cities. So this is the sample. I don't know if it's possible to read the names of all the cities, but it's clear the geographical distribution. Essentially are cities around the Mediterranean Sea and some other cities in Hellenistic kingdoms, the Seleucid kingdom and in Egypt. There is also Phasi on the Black Sea, which was a Greek polis. Now, here are reported the longitudes of the given by Ptolemy for the 80 location in the sample. On the x-axis, there are actual longitudes from Greenwich. So it's clear that the main error is a linear distortion. Here is the equation of the regression line and the coefficient of determination. R2 is just 0.9935. I have to say that I had written a paper on this and I sent it to a geographical journal and they refused because a referee observed that this point can be aligned just by chance. This was the reason for the refusal. So it's clear that there is a linear distortion, and with respect to this error, the other errors are relatively small. And the regression coefficient, which is just the dilation of longitudes, is 1.428. After my work, this is not in my book, this is a later result, Dmitry Shekhlov, who is a historical of ancient geography, considered a less selective sample, included 245 locations. And he included also locations from India and Northern Europe. So it was different to the criterion. The result is that the value of R2 is less near to 1, but is 0.974. This is good enough, I think. But the regression coefficient is exactly the same. He wrote 1.4279, but I have written 1.428 just because four digits, I think, are enough in this connection instead of five. Okay, so the value of the coefficient of the dilation, the ratio, the dilation ratio is much more certain after Shekhlov's work. Now, the first observation is that 1.428 is not too far from 1.4. 1.4 is just the ratio between the measuring stadia of the circumference of the Earth according to Eratosthenes and Ptolemy. So the result is that the distance in stadia along the parallels are essentially the same for Eratosthenes and Ptolemy, because the dilation longitude compensates for the reduced size of the Earth. Since now we know that Ptolemy has deduced the most of his longitudes from distance measured in stadia, drawn largely from Eratosthenes' work on geography, we can conclude that Eratosthenes and Ptolemy had used the same stadia. But this is not a novelty. Most of the scholars believe it. So now, the first idea of my work is just to use the wrong longitudes given by Ptolemy for an estimation of the value of the stadium. So the idea is the following. Ptolemy had translated the distances measured in stadia in degrees of longitude. And we know the ratio you have used. For him, each degree on the maximum circle on the Earth had the length of 500 stadia. So we can go the other way and deduce from his difference of longitude just distance in stadia. But we also know the true distance in kilometers. So we can compute an effective value of the stadium. So here is the computation. I consider just any two location, and I call delta L the difference of longitude, the true difference of longitude, delta LT the difference of longitude according to Ptolemy, so delta LT is dilated with respect to delta L, and we know the ratio is just 1.428. Then I consider the arc of equator between the two meridians through the two locations. And I consider the length of this arc, and the m is the length in meters, and the s is the length in stadia. Now we know the ratio between dm and delta L, of course. The ratio is just 111,000. But we also know the ratio between the ds, the length in stadia, and the difference of longitude according to Ptolemy, because we know that this ratio was 500 according to Ptolemy. So we can compute the ratio between dm and ds. The ratio between dm and ds is just the value in meters of a stadium. The result of the computation is 155.6. So this means that I think that we can discharge the idea that the stadium was the Attica stadium of 185 meters, and is confirmed that the value accepted by most of the scholars, about 157. There is a little difference. I shall come back on this point. So these are the conclusions. The most accredited value is confirmed. Eratosthenes measure had an error of less than 2%. And we can conclude that the Ptolemy's value of the circumference of the Earth were really grossly wrong. So the problem now is to try to explain the origin of the two errors. Now, it's clear that these two errors, the delay, systematic deletion of the difference of longitude and the reduced size of the Earth, are not independent from each other. The problem is to understand if B implied A or the converse was, the first error was A, and from this error was deduced the wrong measure for the Earth. Now, if you suppose, as most of the scholars supposed, that B was the first error, and then was deduced the deletion difference of longitude, there are some points that must be explained. First of all, why Eratosthenes' measure that was accepted by all Hellenistic scientists was refused by Ptolemy? We don't know any source reporting on a new measure of the Earth. So this new measure of the Earth, so wrong, is completely mysterious. And then it's difficult to understand why the new measure could be so made with an error so large. Now, these are I have to say something else for explain the next step. So the problem is the extension of the oikoumene in Greek, according to Ptolemy. The oikoumene is the inhabited world, but it's also the known world. The two concepts coincide. Ora, in Ptolemy's geography, the inhabited world covers exactly 180 degrees of longitude. And western bound, there are the Fortunate Islands, which Ptolemy identifies with the Canaries. In the west, there are some towns in China, not easy to identify. Ora, the ratio between 180 degrees and the actual difference of longitude between Canaries and the Chinese towns in the extreme east is the same ratio of the location in our sample. It's something like 1.43. And the extension of the longitude of inhabited world of 180 degrees was already known to Strabo 150 years before Ptolemy. Now I read a few passages written by Ptolemy. This is the translation is by Bergrand and Jones, the edition of the first two books of the geography published by Princeton University Press. Thus, the first thing that one has to investigate is the Earth's shape, size, so that it will be possible to speak of its known part. This is the oikoumene. How large is this and what it is like? This is just the beginning of the book. Then he writes, it is necessary to give priority to astronomical phenomena over data from record of travel. And then explain in detail the procedure he had followed. It would therefore also be reasonable to give priority in the map to the features that have been obtained to the more accurate than the astronomical, of course. Observation is foundation, so to speak, but to fit the features that come from the other kinds of data, to these, until their positions with respect to each other and to the first fishers stand as much as possible in agreement with those reports, those reports that are less subject to error, the more reliable reports. So it's clear from the analysis of the previous passages that first Ptolemy used a few astronomical data for determining the size and longitude of the inhabited world, and this value was 180 degrees. And we know that the astronomical data were drawn from Hipparchus. Ptolemy writes that Hipparchus was the only reliable source for astronomical data. So then he computed the longitudes of the intermediate location by dividing these 180 degrees in parts proportional to the distance in stadia along a circle of latitude. And these data were drawn from Eratosthenes. So the procedure is clear. Oh, this means that the first error was the dilation of longitudes. And the wrong measure of the art was just a consequence. And we can also understand why Ptolemy had refused the value, the Eratosthenes value, for the size of the earth. Because Hipparchus' fame was greater than that of Eratosthenes, and he knew that Hipparchus had criticized Eratosthenes' work on geography. So data drawn from Hipparchus appeared more reliable than the measure of Eratosthenes. And we can also understand why there is some difference between the dilation ratio, just 1.428, and the ratio 1.4 between the two measures of the earth. Because we have used the value of 500 stadia per degree, but it's probable that this value was just the result of a rounding. This is a rounded value, I think. The value by Eratosthenes, 700, also was a round value. But if he had introduced a new measure, a new value of the stadium, you can think that the new value was just a submultiple of the circumference, just as did French scholars many centuries later. And 252,000 is a number particularly good, because it's as factors all internumbers from 1 to 10. If you consider just the so it's not just in Greek times they were not interested in powers of 10 as round numbers, but in numbers we had many factors. So 252 is 1,000 can be divided by 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 until 10 is the best value. Now the problem becomes the origin of this dilation. Oh, the first point is that Pliny the Elder certainly identified the Fortunate Island with the Canaries, because Pliny gives the distance of the islands from the Pillars of Hercules, so there are no other islands possible. And Ptolemy used for some of the islands the same names of Pliny. And of course, one is writing in Greek and the other in Latin, but the translation is obvious. And so his identification with the Canaries is also certain. Now, the difference of longitude of 180 degrees between the Canaries and this Chinese town at the eastern end of the known world is completely wrong. On the other hand, we know that the distances along the parallels were the same for Eratosthenes and for Ptolemy, and also for Hipparchus. And we know from Strabo that Hipparchus accepted the Eratosthenes measure of the earth. So the problem is, how is it possible that Ptolemy had thrown from a park to the wrong value of 180, deducing it from a wrong side of the earth, given the previous. Now, if you think, it's clear that there is only one possible origin of the error, just a misidentification of the one of the two limits. On the other hand, we can exclude that the misidentification concerned the Chinese towns on the eastern bound, because in this case the original location should be very far into the ocean, in the Pacific Ocean. So we can consider only one possibility. The origin of the error was just a misidentification of the Fortunate Islands. Oh, this misidentification is plausible for several reasons. First, the knowledge about the Atlantic Ocean had collapsed in the period between Parkes and Pliny. And also very important, that this identification of the Fortunate Islands with the Canaries goes back to the time when latitude and longitude had been completely abandoned. So geographers did not use the coordinates. So a misidentification of some island in the ocean became very plausible. And there is also confirmation is obtained if you look at where Ptolemy places these islands. Oh, here in the black circle, the circlet are just the location with the coordinates given by Ptolemy for the Fortunate Islands. So these locations are inside Africa. Oh, this is not so important because one can just say, okay, Ptolemy did not know the geography of Western Africa. But there are two points. One is the error of the latitude. So the latitude of this the mean latitude of these islands, according to Ptolemy, differs from the mean latitude of the Canaries by 15 degrees. Not the same difference of latitude is from Naples to some towns in Sweden. So an error so large can be explained only just as a consequence of a misidentification of the archipelago. And there is also another point, that the coordinates of given by Ptolemy are aligned in direction north-south. On the other hand, the Canary Island extend essentially in the east-west direction. So I think there is no doubt possible that he had confused an archipelago with another one. So here are written things I have. Oh, there is a third point. If you consider the description, there are many descriptions of Fortunate Islands in archaic and classical sources. These descriptions were analyzed by Valerio Massimo Manfredi. Valerio Massimo Manfredi is known mainly as the writer of bestseller, of novels, but he is also a specialist of ancient topography. And before writing his bestseller, he had written a book on the Fortunate Islands, where he has analyzed all the sources on this subject. And the conclusion is that it's impossible to identify these islands with the Canaries. So the next point is, what was the original location of the Fortunate Islands? Since Ptolemy knows, and it seems that he had drawn this knowledge from Hipparchus, He knows that four of the Falkland Islands are on the meridian opposite to eastern bound of the Oikoumene. Other two are just 1 degree to the east of the others. So it's easy to compute their true longitude. Now, first we have to compute the longitude of the eastern bound of the Oikoumene. One possibility is just the identification of this Chinese town, but this identification is very hard. The best way, I think, is just by using our regression line. The regression line gives a relation between the Ptolemy's longitudes and the actual ones. So if I write 180 in the first side of the equation, I have an equation, the true longitude of the eastern bound. And the result is 114 degrees and 6 minutes east. So the westernmost Falkland Islands were on the opposite meridian. And this means that their longitude from Greenwich was 65 degrees and 54 minutes west. Now we have a decisive test at this point. If you consider the island with the latitudes given by Ptolemy, but the longitudes recovered in the way I was said before, we can see where we go, and we can see if there are islands there, and if there is an archipelago similar to the one described by Ptolemy. Now, the circlets are just the coordinates given by Ptolemy recovered in the way I've described. And it's clear that there is an archipelago not too far from this point. These are just the Lesser Antilles. The extension in latitude is about the same, about 5 degrees and 1/2. The extension in longitude is about 1 degree, is also a good approximation. There is a difference in longitude, but not too large. And the archaic and the classical description, the Falkland Islands, are consistent with this identification. The conclusion of Valerio Massimo Manfredi in his book was that all the description becomes understandable if the islands were in the Caribbean. This was the conclusion of his analysis of the... Now I consider a completely different point. I consider a passage in Pliny, a very strange passage in Pliny, which was not understood until now. Pliny writes, "The above is all that I consider worth relating about the length and the breadth of the earth. But Eratosthenes, a man who was peculiarly well skilled in all the more subtle part of learning, and this above everything else, has stated that the wall of the circuit to be 252,000 stadia. Hipparchus, whom we must admire both for the ability with which he controversed Eratosthenes, as well for his diligence in everything else, has added to the above number not much less than 26,000 stadia." Now, this is a very strange passage, first of all, because we know that Hipparchus had accepted the measure of Eratosthenes of the earth. So it's clear that Pliny had not understood this source. So this is a very often occurrence in Pliny's writings. Now, just before this passage, Pliny was discussing the Oikoumene, the known part of the earth. And in Greek, it was usual to use the same word for all the art and for the oikoumene, the known and the inhabited part of the art. Now, here is written the length and the breadth of the earth, but the earth is a sphere, and the sphere has no length different from the breadth. On the other hand, when geographer discuss the oikoumene, always start their discussion, discuss the breadth and the length of the oikoumene. So I think it's clear that the source of Pliny was considering the oikoumene also in this point. And Eratosthenes, it also we know that Eratosthenes had computed the length of the known part of the earth along the parallel of Athens, getting the value of 77,800 stadia. So we can add to this measure 26,000 stadia on the west and just look where we arrive. And we arrive at the longitude 61 degrees and 32 minutes west from Greenwich. So we can conclude that Hipparchus had extended the known part of the world up to that longitude. So where is the meridian 61 degree and 32 minutes? This is the meridian. So we find just the Lesser Antilles. So the conclusion is, this coincidence is much better than the previous one, than this one. And this can be easily understood because here we are used just a number drawn directly from Hipparchus. In the other case, I have used the statistical analysis and there were much more source of error. Oh, there is a third route getting the same result. This is related to the edification tool, but I have no slides at this point. In my book, there is also this. So we have to conclude that Hipparchus was aware of the longitude of some location in Central America. And this, I think, is an important point. I have also, one can ask something, talk of this in before. If they know the Lesser Antilles, it's strange that nobody has seen the American continent. So I reported here two passages of Strabo. I read the first one. We call inhabited, so the oikoumene, the world which we inhabit and know, though it may be that in the same temperate zone there are actually two inhabited worlds, or even more, and particularly in the proximity of the parallel through Athens that is drawn across the Atlantic Sea. So Strabo knows that it's possible that there is another continent on the other end. And this is another passage in Strabo. To give an accurate account of the whole earth and of the whole spondylos. This spondylos is a Greek word which means the portion of the northern hemisphere completed between the equator and the polar circle. The whole spondylos of the zone of which I was speaking is the function of another science, not geography. For instance, take the question whether the spondylos is inhabited in its other half. The other fourth of the world. And indeed, if it is inhabited, it is not inhabited by men such as exist in our fourth. And we should have to regard it as another inhabited world, which is a plausible theory. My task, however, is to describe what is in this our own inhabited world. So this seems that the Strabo knows that in the opinion of Hipparchus, we know that there is another passage just in Strabo in which is reported the opinion of Hipparchus that there should be another continent dividing the ocean to the east of Asia from the ocean to the west of the Pillar of Hercules. And he had deduced this for the fact that the tides in the two oceans had very qualitative features, very different from each other. So it's impossible that it's the same ocean. So my idea is to end here just. So I hope there is some question.
Yeah, I'm sure there are many questions. So let's start here.
Hey, thank you. Another location in Ptolemy which is disputed is Taproban Island. In the seventh book of the geography, after arriving to the very end of the Ecumene, Ptolemy comes back to longitude of 130 and makes the map of Taprobane, which commonly identified with Sri Lanka, but in the early modern era it was also identified with Sumatra or Borneo. Now, Ptolemy states that there are 1,378 islands in the surrounding of Taprobane. I looked and gives the name of some. I looked at their names, and they are unknown names. I did not found them anywhere else. But the second one is named like a Greek theatrical machine. So this is just my supposition, but I think that it is difficult to see a theatrical machine in an island beyond Sri Lanka. There are also the Maldives and some scattered island. This fits more with Celebes or with Indonesia islands, which have strange shapes, so you can think of naming one of them like a machine of theater. More in the beginning of the eighth book, Ptolemy says that he sees many maps with the coast of Asia, which goes northwards after Taprobane, but he thinks that it is an error because would have the map had no space, so he drove the coast upside. So also, I looked at the Periplus of the Eritrean Sea, and it is said that there are islands in the east of Taprobane which are populated by cannibals. So I would like to ask you what do you think of Taprobane, if it is possible that Ptolemy, being stuck with the idea that the Ecumene must be 118 degrees, had passed back the longitude of some island that clearly do not exist where he puts it, because there are no such islands in the Indian Ocean around the equator at the longitude of Sri Lanka, but there are at another longitude.
So these are interesting questions, but I don't have an opinion on this. So the problem of description, the Ptolemy's description of Southern Asia is a difficult problem, as independent from this line of my work. So I have not studied it. There is a professor in Verona, Gorni, who has done some work on this point. I don't know if he had published something, but you can ask him.
Further comments?
There is a museum in the Azores in which they claim that the Fortunate Islands were the Azores themselves. And this is done, I have a picture of this. thing which is written there. And they claim this on the basis of some written text by Hesiodo.
By?
Hesiodo.
Hesiodo.
And some Celtic literature. Are you aware of this?
Yes, there is a very interesting passage in Hesiod where it's saying that in the Fortunate Island there is no difference between summer and winter. So he's speaking about some location in which is not far from tropics. So this is one of the elements pointing in the right direction, converging with my work.
Other questions?
In the regression that you have shown between the longitudes is pretty, is a very, very nice regression with a large correlation. Now, how were the distance, because if I understand correctly, the way to measure the longitude was the one, you had the one regression in your talk with all the points. I don't see it anymore on the screen. Yeah, yes. In this graph, if I understand correctly, the horizontal axis is our measurement. On the vertical axis are measurement of length. Do you say that the longitude was
both measured? Both are angles.
Yes, but the angles on the vertical axis, the Ptolemy longitudes, were measured by, from length at a given distance on a parallel. This is what I understood from you. Am I wrong?
No, I'm not understood. What is the problem?
The vertical axis.
The vertical axis, there are just the longitude written in Ptolemy's geography.
Yeah, and how did the Ptolemy measure the get them? From which information?
How we measure the longitudes. I have tried to explain this. He had drawn from Hipparchus the different longitudes between the eastern and the western bounds of the Oikoumene, and then he had used the distance given by Eratosthenes. And so
exactly.
He had divided these 180 degrees in parts proportional to the distance.
I understood, but essentially...
This is just my reconstruction. The numbers here are just the numbers written in his work.
I understand, but essentially the initial measurement were distances measured along a parallel...
Yes, this is... reconstruction is...
Yes, but I mean, it's very precise. I wonder, how did they measure the distance? How do they measure the distance of the Lesser Antilles from
so the question is about
the precision,
the
yes.
method used by Eratosthenes.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
I mean, it must be very precise. I mean, there is a correlation that is very strong. The precision is typically, the RMS of this distribution must be pretty small. So it's, I mean, they measure the distance very precisely. And I may ask myself, how did they do? Because it was...
I have some idea, but this is a question is independent from my...
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
My idea is one of the way, one of the methods was just to measure the difference of latitude. This can be measured very well.
Yes.
And then... to see the angle between the direction from one city and the other one with respect to the meridian. Now, there is a clue in this direction in the Ptolemy's geography. I think this was one of the methods which were used.
So there would be no actual measurement of length, but it's derived.
Maybe both ways were used, but I think it was used also this one. For example, if the two cities were connected by a sea route, I think the most obvious is to ask about the angle with respect to the north. And probably sailors knew this. and done from a distance, from difference of latitude, we can calculate the difference of longitude.
Other questions? I have myself one. It's a very naive one. So you say that Hipparchus, so in the very last quote that you had, was adding 26,000 stadia to the length estimated by Eratosthenes. So if you looked where you get with the total number of stadia, exactly. But if you subtract the 26,000, you get somewhere in
the east. You mean
exactly.
Oh, I have not tried. Of course, you get into the Pacific Ocean. I think it's not reasonable that the extension was in that direction.
So Eratosthenes was. So my question is whether Eratosthenes' number value was corresponding to some actual place or not?
No,
according to your quote. No?
Yes.
So I think it was Pliny probably. So Eratosthenes had a measure of the length of the known area, and then Hipparchus added 26,000. So I wonder whether at the time of Eratosthenes, so his length was corresponding to an edge, where there were some lands, and then Hipparchus added something more. I mean more islands, more.
Yes. The data are more complete. The source is Strabo, and Strabo does not give only the total measure, but also give the distance along the parallel Athens from the pillars of Hercules to the western bound, according to Eratosthenes. So my computation was based by starting from the pillars of Hercules. So it's not important to know something about Eastern Asia for this computation. So he said just 5,000 stadia along the parallels of Athens from the pillars of Hercules. So there were some islands, of course, not too far from the pillars. And so this was my true starting point, okay.
Any other questions, curiosity? Okay, I don't see any, so we thank Professor Russo again.
Thank you.
And as usual, there will be a refreshment here outside. Everybody's welcome to join.